Hello, I am back with the second half of this illustration, and in this video we are going over coloring. So, coloring is something that I enjoy a lot more than flat out rendering. For a long time, I used to use only color and no lines at all, so I think that I've spent a lot of time learning how color interacts with itself and how to set up different balances of color within an image. I did do something a little bit unwise, which is starting with the foreground and not putting down a base color in the background, which I end up doing in a moment. I decided that I wanted to have a sort of golden glow for this image to have a kind of warm and festive feel to it. So it helps a lot when working digitally to put a color underneath everything to sort of keep everything harmonious. Even if you're using opaque colors and not blending it into the background, it's still really helpful to see how these colors interact with one another inside of a general color scheme. With the gold, I chose colors that I thought would fit with it. So you have more warm-toned, cool colors. By that I mean things like blue and green that are inherently cool tones can still lean warm as opposed to leaning cool. If you look at the green on the middle character shirt, that is a more warm green comparative to a cooler green, which would have more blue in it. It is a little bit difficult to just pick colors out of nowhere when you're working digitally, so I do recommend, if you have any experience with painting, to really let that guide you when it comes to choosing colors. You learn a lot when you paint traditionally in terms of mixing colors and what balances work together. You can keep that in mind when choosing colors from the picker in your digital program. If you've seen a lot of cartoons, you might notice that the backgrounds usually are hand-painted, whereas the foregrounds are cel-shaded with line art. I wanted to kind of keep that feel in this drawing, where the characters in the foreground that are more important were outlined with different line weights depending on how close to the viewer they were. But as I start to work on things in the background, a lot of the lines either end up colored instead of black, or I do some things without lines at all, and this serves to differentiate the foreground from the background. It's a really good trick to keep things from being too cluttered and too confusing when you're looking at it. With a big image like this in an indoor area, it can be a little bit confusing with the lighting source. So I think that what's the most important when keeping these things in mind is that the background behaves how it should with light sources, and then the foreground might be a little bit different for the sake of drama or interest, just that everything within their individual spaces are consistent. So everybody has the same shadows being cast in the same direction in the foreground, which may not necessarily abide by what's going on in the background, because as you get further from light, maybe it doesn't affect things in the distance as much as things that are closer to it do. For the sake of simplicity, I wanted to avoid using too much textural coloring in terms of the characters themselves, but I do apply that to the paladin in the foreground in his cape and on his armor, because when you get really close, it's like real life. When you get really close to something and look at it close up, you can see more detail, and the further you get, you see less detail. So in the foreground, I use that extra texture to make it look as though you have a higher resolution and a crisper view on something, and in the background, again, I use that method of textural, brushy quality to make things seem more vague and less defined. So it's really helpful to think about how you can either make things look blurry and ephemeral versus crisp and detailed using a higher amount of texture. But in the midground, or, you know, the foreground with the characters facing us, it's a little less brushy and more cartoony in the way that it's shaded. I think that strikes a good balance because I don't want to overwhelm the viewers. And also, there's something nice about the cleanliness to it. It is a little bit tricky to make sure that everything is cohesive though, and a lot of that has to do with choosing similarly saturated shadows and colors that are cohesive throughout the piece. What I mean by similarly saturated shadows is that you can look at the green and the yellow of the two characters sitting on the bench next to each other, and relatively, the types of colors are similar, it's just that one is green and one is yellow. So I have these kind of hot, saturated shadows and these more desaturated highlights. And it can help to keep your piece cohesive if you apply the lighting in the same way across different characters. Color can really affect the read of textures as well. So So the food has different applications of color to it to give it different qualities. So the bread has a sort of fluffy shaded brown top to it, like real bread. The chicken maybe looks a little bit oily, like meat can get when it's cooked, or juicy. And the cake is different too, as well as the cups and the plates and everything like that. I did think about adding texture to the table and making it look more wooden, but I thought that there was a certain line of detail that I didn't want to surpass because I didn't want it to, again, get too confusing and muddled. Funnily enough, we had, after I started this illustration, another character join into our party, so I had to add him in. And that's very, very tricky when you already have a composition set up and have to include something that you didn't plan for, especially because it's a big red birdman, so that's pretty noticeable. And I decided that he should go in the middle here, even though I really liked that red banner in the background. And I guess he kind of serves a similar purpose of there being a focal point in this area. But I am a little bummed that I didn't get to have the background in the way that I had planned it. It's not the fault of anybody who came into the party, though, because I love this Birdman, and he's a great character. It's just something that maybe you have to work with sometimes when you are doing art that involves a project, like, with other people, where things might change. So in terms of maybe, like, commissioning or freelance work or anything like that, it might be likely that you have to switch gears in the middle of a project, and it sucks, but it actually ended up turning out pretty good. In fact, I would have had to fudge a lot more, maybe even like boring details in that space that he occupied if he wasn't there, so I think it ended up benefiting the image as a whole. I also like that these characters have sort of like the video game colors. You know what I'm talking about? When you play a video game and player one is a certain color, I think it's blue, then there's red and yellow and green. So it's kind of a reference to how this is a game. It's based off of a game and we're all different players and stuff like that. Maybe I'm the only one who finds that interesting. I don't know, but I added a little bit of detail in the background too, and I don't know if I actually captured it in the video. I don't think I did. So it'll probably just show up in the end, but I added some extra little candles in the tree and some more folks in the background. I kind of got tired of recording. It can be a little bit stressful to have your moves being watched while you're drawing. Well, that is it for this piece. I'm really excited for the campaign that this is related to. I can't make the announcement formally yet, but you might know what's coming. You know, it's something that tends to happen when people decide to play D&D and enjoy the final product. So, just hinting at something that's yet to come. And I'm very excited for this project involving D&D, and I've been illustrating pretty much only things from D&D lately. But it's also really good to finally have a nice motif to follow after. As always, thank you so much for watching my videos. I am very pleased with this piece. It took a long time, but it really pays off when you work hard and have patience, and I'm proud of myself for that. Thank you so much for watching. Happy New Year, and I can't wait to see you in the next video.